and internet marketing. And what I wanted to introduce today was a way of approaching web development that naturally attracts traffic that converts into sales. First of all, how do small businesses naturally develop their websites? Kind of go, well, what products have I got? What services have I got? We'll have a page for all of those things. I'll talk to my graphic designer and I'll make it look nice. We'll have a home page, of course, and we'll have some kind of furniture pages like Contact Us and About Us and that kind of thing. And then we'll publish that, that's fine. Actually, then we've got Twitter and LinkedIn and Facebook. Maybe we ought to do something about that. And maybe we'll have a blog. It's nice to get the kind of quirky stuff into the blog, so that's quite good. And we'll contact that SEO guy that we know, and we'll get some page optimization done. And that's basically what generally happens in a small business website. But the last time I looked, being marketing led meant finding demand and fulfilling, organising yourself to fulfil that demand. So I want to ask you, quick show of hands, I've carefully worded this, put your hands up if you know easily how to find the strength of demand for search phrases in your market. Does that make sense? It's as simple as I can make it. Well, it might be that nobody understood the question. Knowing the demand from the market is obviously crucial. If you've got a better breakfast, you're better off than if you run a guest house. Twice as many people are looking for better breakfast than are looking for guest houses. If you sell games, you've got 15 times the traffic of someone who sells toys. If you're a sleuth, I was trying to find a sleuth the other day, and none of them have websites anyway. But you would talk about your surveillance services, because that gets you twice as much traffic as if you talked about yourself as a private eye. That in itself gets you twice as much traffic as if you talk about yourself as a private investigator. So more people type in private eye than private investigator. Bookkeepers get 3 times as much traffic as payroll services. And roller blinds, there's twice as much traffic for roller blinds as there is for Venetian blinds. So just by knowing where the traffic is and what people are searching for, you can naturally attract traffic to your website. It's no more work, you're just writing about this rather than that. But there's a caveat to it. It's this business about research phrases and buying phrases. There were 201,000 searches for roller blinds in the UK last month. But most of those people will have been just mooching around. They haven't decided to buy roller blinds yet. They're just wondering whether to buy curtains or print the thing up, or whether they're going to buy a roller blind from a fitted place or buy one that's coming in standard sizes or whatever. They haven't yet decided to buy anything, they're just exploring. But there were 4,000 people looking for aluminium Venetian blinds. So that's someone who's much further along the buying stage. They know what they want and they're about to buy it. So there's quite a lot of traffic on the research phrases, but they don't buy, but there's less traffic. But they convert better on these kind of longer phrases, more specific phrases. So if you were selling blinds, you'd obviously have your window blinds page, and you'd split that out then into Venetian blinds and roller blinds and whatnot. And under Venetian blinds, then you'd start to talk about some of these phrases that actually convert, like wooden Venetian blinds and aluminium Venetian blinds and PVC Venetian blinds, bears, cords, how to clean them, dusters for them, accessories for them, and all the different colours. So these are all phrases that people who are ready to buy will use in Google and come to your website and actually buy them. So you write your article about aluminium Venetian blinds, and maybe you adapt it for your blog, and then you probably link to it from your Twitter account and your LinkedIn and your Facebook. And maybe it would be good enough to be a PR story, so it could go out and be reused again as a PR story and go out on the press. It could go out as a syndicated article, which is where you use, you adapt the article and let people publish it online in return for a link back to your website. And if you've done all that kind of work on this, on that one subject, then you might as well go on and do a podcast. You might as well go on, if you've done a podcast, to do a video. And what you're doing then is you're dealing with the different modalities that people like to deal in. So some people like to receive information by video, by watching TV. Some people prefer it by radio. Some people want to have a printout and read, whatever. There's quite a lot more people than I expect. How many people actually listen to podcasts? I don't, but lots of people do. Yeah. I'm told that people in, you know, listen to podcasts on the commute, you know, it's obviously a good place to stock up on ideas for a good business day. So let's just look at it from the customer's point of view. Who wants this aluminium Venetian blind? So they type that into Google and they'll see your video. And they click on that and end up in YouTube. And they watch your video and they see you, and they start to get to know you, and they see your presentation on aluminium Venetian blinds, and they come to the end of that and they click the link that you give them. And that link goes not just to your website but to your page about aluminium Venetian blinds. So you've skipped through all of the navigation for them and you take them basically to the buy page. And on that buy page you've got normal sales stuff, you've got like the Facebook like button, testimonials, case studies, that kind of thing. A bit of scarcity, maybe only one left, maybe an offer, buy button, obviously, good stuff to help them trust that you're the right person to buy this aluminium Venetian blind from right there. But secretly, you're also testing that page. That page is one of two versions. Maybe you have two different photographs, let's say. So you've got an A page and a B page. And as people arrive, they're automatically allocated one or another of these pages. So some people see one photograph, some people see the other photograph. And if you get 100 people to each page, you get 200 people to visit, to go through that process and end up at your website. Half of them will go to the A version, half of them will go to the B version. And they will always get that version themselves, so it's a bit confusing. Back in the control room at your end, you can see that you've had 100 visitors to version A of the page, 100 visitors to version B of the page. Maybe you sold one on version A and two on version B, so you can think, well, the photograph on the version B page is converting better. Let that run until it's statistically significant. In other words, you've got enough people that it's actually true that one photograph is convertible. And then you ditch the rubbish page and you take the good page and you do another test. So you can test headlines, first paragraphs, layouts, prices, classes. So, in conclusion, what you have there is a listening web system that sniffs out and reacts to market demands. reaches out to where your customers are, and holds their hand and brings them back to the right part of your website. And that part of your website is adapting and evolving based on customer behavior so that it becomes more and more persuasive as time goes on. And that's how you build a website. That's it. I've got also, I've come from Scarborough, so if you don't get to talk to me today, then look up Scarborough Internet Marketing and we'll find it there. That will be by the end of the year.
Thank you very much.